Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. You're watching Trending Tonight with me, Sanket Upadhyay. Two stories we are going to track right here. Story number one, the big meeting that took place between the Prime Minister and leaders of all parties, including the BJP, from Bihar. But this is not an issue related to just Bihar. In fact, in Uttar Pradesh too, which is poll-bound, and other states, there have been demands that there should be a caste census. Now, this is an exercise that was stopped in 1931. The big question that we are asking at this moment, because back then, the argument that was given was that why do you want to divide society? You want to make schemes, make them on the basis of the economic status of people. Have those government schemes. That is what went on till now. But now political parties say no caste census, because that is what is going to help the various castes, particularly OBC. So the question that we are asking, is it in national interest? And we'll go across to our guests in just a short moment. And also any legal challenges from here. Story number two, there is a Captain versus Sidhu war, and the drama continues. It's a daily soap opera now. In today's episode, there is a war over the pro-Pakistani advisor. Pro-Pak in quotes, because that's what he has been called. Navjot Singh Sidhu's men are speaking against the captain, but in their utterances, they also spoke against in national interest. They did not speak in national interest. They said something which was detrimental to India's sovereign integrity. How long will this drama continue? And is this frankly embarrassing the Congress party? We'll go to that story also in just a short moment. But on story number one, I would like to introduce our guest, Yogendra Yadav, National President of Swaraj India, has written a fantastic piece today in the print. Ajit Sharma, MLA of the Congress party from Bihar, who was part of the delegation. He was part of the delegation who met the Prime Minister. And we also have Mr. Sanjay Hegde. He's a senior lawyer. Thank you very much, Mr. Hegde, for joining us. Mr. Yadav, I would like to begin with you first. In your piece, you say that, this is the moment this caste census is out, it will expose the political doings of all political dispensations in power, because it will truly reveal the extent of how much things have not been done. Could you just elaborate that for our viewers?
Sanket, I'd like to simply clarify something.
Sure.
There's something very strange and funny about debates on caste census in India, because it absolutely becomes a debate on caste reservation, which it need not be. Hmm. Now, suppose you are someone who's opposed to caste reservation, and many people are. Now, you believe that, okay, these people who are getting reservation should not get, because they are actually already quite good, their economic condition is decent, in which case you would want evidence. You would want a caste census, because you believe that it will expose that OBCs should not get reservation, or at least some jatis within OBCs have done so well that they should be thrown out. Hmm. Isn't it amazing, Sanket, that those who day in and out say no reservation, it's not based on correct facts, say don't collect facts. This is astonishing. Second, as amazing thing, Sanket, can you think of any country in the world which has a legal scheme to benefit some section of society? It could be blacks, it could be Hispanics, it could be women, it could be whatever. And who says we won't can't count this particular category? I mean, this is more than ridiculous. There cannot be any modern country in the world which has a scheme of reservation. And mind you, we have reservation now for OBCs for 3 decades. Hmm. It is a scandal that we do not count something that we actually are willing to extend reservations and affirmative action.
No, to that point, I would like to add, and maybe you can weigh in. See, the point is reservation, Mr. Yadav, as you also are aware, was a short-term exercise to end the imbalance in the society and get people, to reach certain standing. Now, if you don't have a census, you're saying we will never know whether people have been able to get the benefits of reservation or not. And thus, it is going to be counterproductive.
Absolutely, Sanket. That's one part of it. And I thought every reasonable person in this country, whether they are for reservation or they are against reservation, they should demand counting, because it would prove, because we want correct evidence. Courts in this country have repeatedly said, make reservation policies, but only based on evidence. And mind you, when you say caste-based census, it does give you economic information. So if you believe that people who are poor are cutting across all caste and communities, you will get perfect evidence from this caste census. So why are people afraid? And the second thing that I do want to mention, we keep talking, and that's a point that I draw upon from Professor Satish Deshpande, who's made it very, very powerful. He says that, look, it's not merely about the disadvantage for whose favor you want to have this particular caste census. The whole point of caste census, he says, is to count the privilege of the rich, of the well-to-do. You know, in India, it's very, I think I find it very easy to convince English-speaking Indians by giving examples from US. So in US, they know something called white privilege. In our country, the equivalent of white privilege is Hindu upper caste privilege. In population, they are about 20%. They could be 19, they could be 22 max. This particular category is present in about 80% of all positions of privilege in our society. I say it with some sense, with some responsibility.
Yeah, this was there in your piece as well. Yeah,
absolutely. So why is it that we don't want to count? Is it that this most privileged section of society
is afraid
that their privileges
will
come out? No, they may not lose it, but it will be exposed that they enjoy this kind of advantages. This is what the biggest privilege in the world, Sanket, is to decide whether your privileges should be known or not known.
True. Very well said. Sanjay Hegde, now let's talk about the legal challenges. A lot has been said, and the government we have seen has repeatedly said that this is going to be a huge exercise, big burden. I also heard from certain sections of the government, though there I must admit, openly the government is not rejecting the idea, because this is a very, very difficult issue. You cannot be seen on the wrong side of anything to do with caste in this country. But they do highlight how this is going to be a legal and procedural challenge. Legally, Mr. Hegde, what is the challenge?
I don't think there is a legal challenge. There can't be a legal challenge to collection of data. In the census, what is going to happen? In addition to the usual columns, you will also have to specify what caste you claim to be based on ancestry of your father or even any other basis. After that, it is in the collation of data and what you do with the data that there may be legal challenges. Now, if the census reveals that there are so many people of a certain caste and that caste has not been adequately represented in government service, that is, you will have one piece of data from the caste from the census, and you may have other pieces of evidence from all your recruitment records. When you bring that together, you say that people of this caste are not adequately represented. Then there may be legal challenges. Legal challenges to the caste census, there are none. Legal challenges based upon the data generated by the caste census, well, anything and everything can end up in court. For fear of legal challenges, you cannot say that I will not collect data. And as Yogendra correctly pointed out, the Supreme Court has said that whenever you make reservations, they should be backed by data. There has been the late Kashiram's formula, jiski jitni sankhya bari, uski utni hissedari. There is a certain sense of hissedari, of participation in public power, which has to be evenly distributed. If it is unevenly distributed, And
you're saying the only way to find whether it has been evenly distributed is not through, conjecture, but through data. And that's why you
Absolutely.
Need this census. Yeah.
Can I add a word to what Mr. Hegde has said? Just to, in fact, what Mr. Hegde says is exactly what has been practiced for the last 70 years, at least for 25% of our population. For the scheduled caste and scheduled tribe, in every census we record, are you SC or ST? If they are, then their jati is recorded and it's enumerated. And it's not merely how many persons from this jati. The census also tells us from this jati how many are matriculate, how many are graduate, how many have certain kinds of commodities in their house, how many have pakka house. All this information is routinely available for SC, ST jati-wise in our census. All we are saying is extend it at least to OBCs and if possible to everyone else as well.
Ajit Sharma ji, you were there part of the delegation, a very unique one of a kind, because it's so rare to have opposition, government, everyone on one platform agreeing to one thing. Mr. Sharma, I want to know from you, this reservation, and not quota, but this reservation that is being expressed ki bhai isko nahi karate ya iske bare mein soch le, aapko kyun lagta hai ki aisa kyun bola ja raha hai?
देखिए, ऐसा है, सबको तो पहले नमस्कार।
नमस्कार।
आपको ये बता दूं कि ये जो रिजर्वेशन जाति आधार पे जो जनगणना की बात हो रही है, ये देश के हित में है। मैंने उनको पत्र भी माननीय प्रधानमंत्री जी को दिया है कि चाहे जाति जनगणना हो या मंडल कमीशन हो या मंडल कमीशन पार्ट टू, सबका आधार क्या, आरक्षण। और उच्चतम न्यायालय ने भी बोला था कि कैपिंग 50% माननीय उच्च न्यायालय के संवैधानिक बेंच के द्वारा जारी हो चुकी है। मेरा मानना है, जो हम लोगों ने पूरा डेलीगेशन 10 दल के लोगों ने माननीय मुख्यमंत्री के नेतृत्व में हम लोगों ने माननीय प्रधानमंत्री से मिला, सबसे पहले मैं माननीय प्रधानमंत्री जी को शुक्रिया अदा करना चाहता हूँ कि आपने सभी बिहार के सभी दलों को, चाहे वो सत्ता पक्ष का हो या विपक्ष का हो, सभी को आपने बुला के बात सुनने का काम किया। और देखिए, बिहार की ही नहीं बात है, पूरे देश में अगर जाति का जनगणना होता है और उसमें कोई क्रीमी लेयर कितने हैं, नन क्रीमी लेयर गरीब लोग कितने हैं, उसकी जनगणना बहुत आवश्यक है। चूंकि 1931 में पहली बार हुआ था, उसके बाद 2011 में यूपीओ सरकार की गवर्नमेंट ने जनगणना कराने का जातिवाद प्रयास किया, लेकिन उसमें कुछ त्रुटि हो गई, जारी नहीं हो सका, सरकार चली गई। 2014 में भारतीय जनता पार्टी, आदरणीय नरेंद्र मोदी जी बने हैं। मैं आपको बता दूं भीतर की बात, आदरणीय प्रधानमंत्री जी ने सबों की बात, सभी दल के नेता, जो 10 दल हम लोग आए थे विपक्ष पक्ष के, सबकी बात सुनी है और उन्होंने बहुत गंभीरता से सुनी है। और उनका जो बॉडी लैंग्वेज था, जो चेहरे का एक्सप्रेशन था, उन्होंने लास्ट में जो कंक्लूड किया, यही कि मैं सारी बात सुना हूं, इसको मैं लोगों से बात करके इसको देखूंगा,
फिर उसके बाद क्या? मैं इस पर निर्णय लूंगा। नहीं आता,
लेकिन आपको बता दिए,
कीप्स चेंजिंग।
हाँ, बोलिए।
बीजेपी की ये जो पोजीशन है, ये बदलती रहती है। आपसे ये सवाल नहीं पूछना चाहिए, किसी बीजेपी वाले से ही पूछना चाहिए, लेकिन आपको क्या लगता है कि इसको फिर अब तक क्या रोक रहे?
मैं बताता हूँ, हम लोग के डेलीगेशन में भारतीय जनता पार्टी से आदरणीय मंत्री जनक राम जी थे, उन्होंने भी आदरणीय प्रधानमंत्री जी को बोला है कि सदन में तो सभी लोगों ने सर्वसम्मति पास किया कि हम लोग, मुख्यमंत्री जो बोल रहे हैं, सब लोग उसके साथ हम हैं, बाहर में क्या बोलते हैं छोड़ दीजिए। लेकिन आपको बता दें, एक ऐतिहासिक फैसला होगा प्रधानमंत्री जी का, और ये जनगणना आर्थिक रूप से, जनगणना अगर होता है आर्थिक रूप और जाति जनगणना, आपको बता दें जो गरीब लोग हैं, चूंकि 1931 में हुआ है, इतने गरीब लोग हैं, किस जाति के हैं ये जानना जरूरी है।
लेकिन मुझे एक चीज,
केंद्र सरकार में नौकरी हो
या
बिहार सरकार में नौकरी सरकारी हो, या फिर जो मदद करने की नीति बनानी हो बिहार सरकार को या किसी,
नहीं, नॉट जस्ट बिहार सरकार, फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल दिस इज नॉट अ मैटर रिस्ट्रिक्टेड टू जस्ट बिहार,
क्योंकि भारत मैटर अबाउट द कंट्री, अग्रिम भूमिका
जी। अजीत जी, वापस आता हूं आपके पास, योगेन यादव,
आदरणीय नरेंद्र मोदी जी जाति आधार पर जनगणना कराएं, और जो गरीब लोग हैं, जो उपेक्षित हैं, उनको नियम बना के उनको मदद करने का काम करें, तो उनका एक ऐतिहासिक नाम होगा और नरेंद्र मोदी जी को याद किया।
ओके, फाइन, आई एम कम, आई विल कम बैक टू यू अजीत जी। योगेन यादव, आई वांट टू कम टू यू नाउ। यू सी,
ओके,
इफ द गवर्नमेंट डज दिस, इट विल बी हेल्ड पॉलिटिकली, बट द पॉइंट इज, all this while policies have been made on the basis of economically, how economically backward you are. See, ultimately that is the motive of a government, to make sure that people have a good standard of living. Why can that not be, see, it's often said that once you will know, there will be a caste census, you will know which caste has not been benefited. Why can schemes not continue to be on the basis of economic backwardness and not social backwardness?
Sanket, I think we need to separate these two debates. The first debate is simply about collection of information. And when we say caste-based census information, we are not talking only of counting of caste, we are also talking of counting how many persons in each caste community are educated, how many are well off, how many are employed in which kinds of job. All this information gets collected. I want to add to what Mr. Ajit Sharma was saying.
But how could that help, right, Yogenji? Say, for instance, because, if in a particular community, 10 people are prosperous and about 10 are not, then what decision do you make?
The courts have been saying repeatedly, in fact, this was one of the critical points made by Indira Sahni judgment. They said, all right, we are saying okay to OBC reservations, but within 10 years, please review and see if some caste communities have moved ahead and they don't need reservation anymore. That would require collection of information, which we have not made at all. That's why I'm saying,
because politically nobody wants to take this decision. Which political party will take this?
Exactly. So we are speaking of national interest. Is it in country's interest? And to my mind, I possibly cannot see any reason. Honestly, Sanket, this is one of the biggest scandals of this country, that you start OBC reservation in 1990. By then, the 91 survey had, the census had already begun, so it was too late. I understand that. In 1999, the Registrar General of Census, Mr. Vijay Munni, demanded that it should be done. The BJP government of that time simply spiked that idea. All right. 2010, the Parliament of India, with a unanimous resolution which included BJP, said please count caste in 2011. At that point, Mr. Chidambaram ministry, unfortunately, became an instrument of upper caste aims, and they actually stymied, they sabotaged that particular thing by delegating it to something else. Then comes BJP. In 2018, Mr. Rajnath Singh gives a promise on the floor of Lok Sabha saying we shall count OBCs. 2019 elections get over, they forget about it. And it's not only Bihar government, six governments have asked for it. The National Backward Caste Commission has requested this. The Parliamentary Committee on Welfare of OBCs has asked for it. What more input do you need for a decision?
I think for any decision to be taken, since so much has been discussed and the Prime Minister has met a delegation from Bihar, thank you very much to the three of you. Obviously, Bihar is not the country. So, the Prime Minister may want to meet other leaders also and get a consensus on how many want this caste census. Keeping the politics aside, can this actually be in national interest? Thank you very much. Let's move on now. Story number two. There is a daily soap opera happening in Punjab. This time around, this was a battle between the captain's camp and Sidhu's camp over certain utterances by the advisor of Navjot Singh Sidhu, which was seen as quote-unquote pro-Pakistan. Those details will run in graphics on the screen right now. I would like to introduce one such critic, Mr. Manish Tiwari. You criticized this individual, Mr. Mali, who made these utterances. Would you say that these utterances, which can be called, or you are calling them pro-Pakistan, have embarrassed or are an embarrassment for your party?
Sanket, I have been spokesperson of the Congress Party now from 2008, which effectively makes it a continuous run of 14 years. I have been also spokesperson for the cabinet and for the government. I rarely comment on any intra-party issue, but the reason why I was compelled to do so today is because the statements which had been made have both profound national and international implications. The fact is that we need to look at the context in which India, or for that matter, the border states of India, stand today. The takeover of Afghanistan by Taliban has given a huge fillip to the ISI, Pakistan military deep state combined on one hand, and to all the extremist and terrorist forces across the world, you know, be it the Hamas, be it the Hezbollah, be it the Daesh, be it the Al-Qaeda, be it the Islamic State, all across the Middle East. And therefore, under those circumstances, for someone to opine that Jammu and Kashmir is not an integral part of India, or for someone else to opine that we should go soft on Pakistan at a point in time when drones laden with arms, ammunition and narcotics are being infiltrated on a daily basis in Punjab, has very serious, huge negative repercussions, not only for India, but given the regional context in which India finds itself. And therefore, I felt compelled, both as a nationalist and as someone who has anchored the Congress Party's communication remit now for over a decade, to put the record straight.
Mr. Tiwari, you think that in that sense, Mr. Sidhu must change his advisors and maybe they should be asked to issue an unconditional apology? Surely the party won't stand with
them. Well, I am no one to advise anybody with regard to who they decide to choose or have as their advisors. That's entirely the discretion of the gentleman in question. But however, as I have articulated earlier and enunciated the position, which is the consensual position of the Indian Parliament through its resolution of 1994, reiterated in 2012, that Kashmir is an Jammu and Kashmir is an integral part of India, and the only unfinished business of partition is the reclaim of those lands which are still under the illegal occupation of Pakistan. I leave it to the judgment of the gentleman in question to decide the appropriate course of action.
Sure. Mr. Tiwari, do you think that these utterances and this constant infighting, I'm asking this like a broader question, could cost the Congress Party the Punjab election? I mean, from last year when it was being said that at the back of the farmers' agitation, it's a done deal for the Congress, to now this constant infighting and bickering?
Well, there are certain issues which are beyond elections. There are certain issues which have a direct and germane bearing on national interest. Jammu and Kashmir and the position of the Indian state qua Jammu and Kashmir is one of those issues. You see, we have problems with this government with regard to the abrogation of Article 370, with the dismemberment of the state of Jammu and Kashmir into two union territories. I had led the discussion on that on behalf of the Indian National Congress in the Lok Sabha, and we had articulated our position very strongly. We had also voted against the Jammu and Kashmir Reorganization Bill and the various resolutions which the government had brought before the Lok Sabha and the Raj Sabha. But at no point in time has that been the position of the Indian National Congress, and much less its responsible functionaries, that Jammu and Kashmir is not an integral part of India. Jammu and Kashmir is an integral part of India, will continue to remain an integral part of India. Sure. And those people who do not subscribe to this particular point of view, I am afraid, this would almost tantamount to transgressing the freedom of speech and expression and actually loitering into the arena of sedition.
Oh, okay. That's a strong comment that you have made against people who are affiliated with your own party men. But Mr. Sidhu, as well as his advisors, are constantly and publicly criticizing Captain Amrinder Singh. Do you think this will send a bad message to the electorate just ahead of elections?
Well, I am not here to discuss the intra-party politics of Punjab. The only reason why I agreed to come on your show, Sanket, is primarily because the issue of Jammu and Kashmir, and also the fact that Pakistan and the deep state of Pakistan has been emboldened by the takeover of Afghanistan by the Taliban, a force which they have incubated, nurtured, funded, patronized, protected, sheltered, from 1994 right up till 2021, the fact that despite being an ally on the U.S. war on terror, with the U.S. in the war on terror, the Pakistani deep state ran with the hare and hunted with the hound. They sheltered Osama bin Laden in Tora Bora earlier and later on in Abbottabad. And now with the changed and altered situation in Afghanistan and the implications that it can possibly have in Jammu and Kashmir especially, and in Punjab by corollary being a border state, it is very important that everybody should be on the same page, sure, insofar as our fight against terror and those organizations which patronize, support, and have been constantly in the vanguard of promoting cross-border terror. That is the larger question. What happens, you know, in a particular election? What happens in a particular political context when it becomes completely secondary, when national interest is involved?
Sure. Mr. Tiwari, thank you very much for joining us right here on this show. With that, we come to an end of this broadcast. News continues on the other side. Stay with us.